Good morning, everyone. Pastor Joe is at the Huntington Beach campus today. So, I get to preach my very first Palm Sunday message with you guys. First service got it first, but it flowed and everything went well. Praise God. But, it gets intimidating. I did Christmas Day service. Joe got sick. And it was that's an intimidating time. This is a big deal, the birth of Jesus. And I just come to find out, this is a big deal. But it's what it comes down to? I get to talk about Jesus. How lucky am I that I get to share Jesus with you guys today? And I'm super excited. And I'm going to get a little teachy today. We're gonna go back into the Old Testament, and don't roll your eyes. Oh, Old Testament. Because you know what? The Old Testament is fascinating because the Old Testament and the New Testament tie together, and they point to Jesus. It all makes sense. It's really cool, and it's fascinating to see that. So I'm gonna point that out a little bit today. But what a glorious start Palm Sunday to the best day ever, right? All right, not only did our Lord and Savior, sacrifice himself, but Easter Sunday, the day that we celebrate his resurrection, he showed us that he is who he says he is. He showed us that he wasn't just somebody woofing a bunch of stuff, but he, through the Spirit of God, the same Spirit of God that lives in us today, resurrected from the dead and is alive today. Amen? And that's that's the best day ever for Christians and sinners in general. We have a risen King. We have one that took one for the team. Amen? So, today is the triumphant entry to Jerusalem where Jesus finally allows his people to publicly announce him as Messiah and King. Now, up to this point, Jesus has been healing the sick, and he's been casting out demons, and he's been doing all these great, wonderful things, but he's saying stuff like, go in peace, but don't tell anyone. My time has not yet come. You see, Jesus was still, even though he was a big deal and they usually end up running and telling everybody anyway, he wasn't ready to announce the fact of who he was yet. And he would tell people, don't tell anybody, or you know what, my time has not yet come. So what we need to remember is Jesus is always in control. Through that whole thing, through every step, God was in control. And I know that we know this, but let me just remind us all that Jesus wasn't murdered. He gave himself up as a sacrifice. So as children of God, that should be comforting to us, knowing that, when everybody saw the devastation, Jesus brutally beaten, crucified on a cross. I mean, this wonderful man, this wonderful God, and they had an idea of, they knew Jesus was, some of them at least knew Jesus was God, and they knew that, he was supposed to be the King of Jerusalem, and they saw devastation. God was in control of that. They didn't understand the plan, but they knew who Jesus was. Just like we don't always understand what's going on, we know who Jesus is. That Jesus is who he says he is. And that he's got a plan, and it's all part of the plan. Even when we don't like it, even when we don't understand it, even when it's painful, there's a plan. And when we rest in that and know that God is good all the time and He is perfect, it can kind of, it allows us to take the pressure off and just trust Him. Amen. Thank you, sister. So let me read this. Isaiah 46, 9 and 10. Remember the former things, those of long ago. I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me. I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times, what is still to come. I say, my purpose will stand and I will do all that I please. That is a bold statement that only God could make or live up to. Amen? So, when I was studying for this and I read this scripture, I thought of myself at my worst. I mean, the time where I was just shooting meth and heroin and coke, yuck! I mean, I was just deep darkness, thank you. I was just way away from God. Didn't know Him, didn't think about Him. I was just annihilated. Spiritually, physically, mentally, emotionally, relationally, destroyed. God loved me. God saw the end from the beginning. And God had a plan. I want you to think of your worst. And we all have different worsts. I really hope you've never shot meth, because it's really... it's not a good place to go, trust me. But you've had your place where it was your worst. You didn't feel lovable. You didn't feel like you deserved forgiveness. You didn't feel like you were clean. God loved you then as much as He loves you now. Thank you, Jesus. And is that not comforting? Because I'm just like, woo! Because see, I was a scumbag. You know what I mean? Like, woo! Tagged and bagged for sin, death, and hell. You know what I mean? Like, I was an easy pickings for the devil. God said, nuh-uh, that's my kid. I mean, I can't believe I'm standing here today preaching the gospel to you guys. Hallelujah! Jesus is alive! You know? We all have something to celebrate with this. And I'm like super stoked because I'm just talking about the lead up to today. And it's awesome. It's still awesome. So let's get into this. Jesus rides into Jerusalem 4 days before He was to be crucified. 4 days. Why is this important? Because the Passover lamb must be presented 4 days before Passover, according to the Old Testament. Jesus is into the details. God's not a messy God. He is very, very precise. He doesn't just haphazardly do things. It is precise. And we'll see in this, because He's very particular about the stuff that He wants and the stuff that He does. So this is the Israelites are still in bondage in Egypt. And Moses keeps going to Pharaoh going, "Let my people go. Let my people go." And He's like, "Nope, nope, nope." So God keeps sending plague after plague after plague. And instead of Pharaoh going, all right, get out of here," his heart gets hardened. And this is what happens. This is the Passover. Verse 12. The Lord says to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, "This month is to be for you the first month of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. If any household is too small for the whole lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbor. having taken into account the number of people there are. You are to determine the amount of lamb needed in accordance with each person, with what each person will eat. The animals you choose must be year-old males without defect, and you may take them from the sheep or the goats. Take care of them until the 14th day of the month, when all the members of the community of Israel must slaughter them at twilight. Then they are to take some of the blood and put it on the sides and the tops of the door frames of the houses where they eat the lambs. That same night they are to eat the meat roasted over the fire, along with bitter herbs and bread made without yeast. Do not eat the meat raw or boiled in water, but roast it over a fire with the head, legs, and internal organs. Gross. whatever you say. Do not leave any of it until morning. If some of it is left until morning, you must burn it. This is how you are to eat it. With your cloak tucked into your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. Verse 12, on that same night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn of both people and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on those houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. This is a day you are to commemorate for the generations to come. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance. So this is the Passover. Jesus is the final Passover lamb. Jesus is the final sacrifice for sin. And we are covered by his blood. See, the sacrifices then, they would atone for the sin or cover the sin, but Jesus' blood removes it. It removes it. God doesn't look at us through a sin-colored lens. He sees us through the blood of Jesus. He sees us perfect and whole. When Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, we are covered by his blood. God sees us through Jesus. Amen? This is why we honor the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I mean, he saved us. I don't know about you, but there's no way I could have lived up to the Ten Commandments. No way. Now, this was all perfectly executed to fulfill Scripture, all done with God's plan and design. In John the Baptist is baptizing, and Jesus approaches to get baptized when he started his ministry. For John chapter 1, 29 through 31 says this, the next day John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, a man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel. John sees him and says, there's the Lamb of God. There's the one who's going to handle business for everyone. Right there. As soon as he saw him, he recognized him. And he prophesied that. So, let's get to when Jesus rides into Jerusalem. Before I start, because I was studying this and I looked a little bit before and it amazed me, because right before Jesus goes into Jerusalem, you know, he's going to ride in on a donkey. Before he announces, you know, the announcement of his kingship, of you know, Hosanna, he is in he's in Jericho and he's ministering to his disciples and the crowd around him. And he drops this bomb before he leaves to step in to that, you know, his time to be the sacrificial lamb. It was on and cracking. So he leaves, he drops this mic drop parable. And I wanted to share it with you because it's truth. Luke 19, 11 through 27. hang in there with me, guys. I know I'm reading a lot of scripture, but it's relevant. And it's scripture, right? You can't lose. Amen. I'm not going to apologize for that. Okay. The parable of the 10 minas. While they were listening to this, he went on to tell them a parable because he was near Jerusalem and the people thought that the kingdom of God was going to appear at once. They thought Jesus was just going to get on the throne and everything was going to be good. They didn't understand the plan. They're understanding who he is, but they don't understand the plan. So Jesus says this, verse 12. Jesus said, "A man of noble birth went to a distant country to have himself appointed king and then to return. So he called 10 of his servants and gave them 10 minas. Put this money to work, he said, until I come back. But his subjects hated him and sent a delegation after him to say, 'We don't want this man to be our king.' He was made king, however, and returned home. Then he sent for the servants whom he had given the money, in order to find out what they had gained with it. The first one came and said, 'Sir, your mina has earned 10 more.' 'Well done, my good servant,' his master replied. 'Because you have been trustworthy in a very small matter, take charge of 10 cities.' The second came and said, 'Sir, your mina has earned 5 more.' His master answered, 'You take charge of 5 cities.' Then another servant came and said, 'Sir, here's your mina. I've kept it laid away in a piece of cloth. I was afraid of you because you're a hard man. You take out what you did not put in, and you reap what you did not sow.' His master replied, 'I will judge you by your own words, you wicked servant. You knew, did you, that I'm a hard man, taking out what I did not put in and reaping what I did not sow? Why didn't you put my money on deposit so then when I came back, I could have collected it with interest?' Then he said to those standing by, 'Take his mina away from him and give it to the one who has 10. "Sir," he said, "he already has 10. He replied, "I tell you that to everyone who has, more will be given. But as for the one who has nothing, even what they have will be taken away. But those enemies of mine who didn't want me to be king over them, bring them here and kill them in front of me." This is Jesus. This is sweet little baby Jesus. The Passover lamb, so humble, so nice, doesn't get angry. You know what I mean? Because I think that we can see him like that. And we should, because he's God and he was perfect. He didn't lose control of his emotions. He did get righteously angry and turn over the tables in the temple. But for the most part, even when people were doing him dirty, he kept his cool. Amen? But this is the parable that he drops before he leaves. Because this, see, especially in our day today, this is not politically correct. This is going to rub some people the wrong way. This is going to hurt people's feelings. It's like, oh my gosh, how mean of him to say that before he saved us. But here's the thing. Jesus isn't interested in being politically correct. He's interested in telling you the truth. Okay, so for the servant, that's his children. That's us. He's obviously talking about his servants collecting what he so freely gave. Putting that to use. I call it stacking chips for Jesus. Right? He's so freely given us salvation, the ability to love, forgive, the ability to if you know, when we walk with him and talk with him and we do it his way, man, relationships are mended. So many miracles in our life happen. What are we doing with it? Because Jesus says this before he goes. And his time had come. But he says this to his servants as an example. Do we have the love of God and, you know, and our relationship with God hidden under a little cloth? it seems to me Jesus has said here that he's not going to be real happy with that. Now, I'm not going to cut you open and just leave you there bleeding, okay? There's enough grace and mercy. God is full. He's perfect, okay? And it's never too late to start. And I want to share something with you too, because the Bible says that there's no condemnation in Christ. So if anybody that's in here is feeling condemned about what was just read, I rebuke that in the name of Jesus. I want to convict today through the word, but not condemn. And I want to share something with you. When I first got saved, I was lit on fire. I loved Jesus. I believed it. I mean, I was in. I remember being at like a grocery store or something and seeing somebody from church, and they yelled out, "Praise God," or "Jesus," or something like that. And I was like, like, I was literally embarrassed, like, somebody's going to hear, you know, like, whoa. I mean, I had to grow through that, but I'm sharing that with you because I don't want you to think that it isn't all a process. And Jesus has plenty of grace and mercy to help us out along the way. But I do want to, I have to give you the truth today, amen? Jesus said this. He said it. So it's important for us as kids to live as beacons of light in this dying world. To be willing to, and I'm not talking about clubbing people over the head with a Bible, you know what I mean, or screaming at them. I'm talking about walking and talking exactly, being the same person we are over here is the same person we are over here, and man, there's something about that person. There's something about them that is attractive. They don't completely turn into a pile of goo when adversity comes. Why? What's up with that? Their marriage was so jacked up, and it's good now. What happened? Oh, well, you know, I heard they're going to church. You know what I mean? Or you have the opportunity. Finally, they go, "What's up with you?" Well, I gave my life to Jesus, man. You know, you don't have to be all, "Oh, I should be eloquent." No, you just tell them the truth. I started going to church, man. Things started changing. Jesus changed the way that I think. And he's changed my relationships. He's changed my heart. It's real easy, but I understand if you're walking through that fear. Don't feel condemned, but I want you to know you don't have to be afraid to say you're a Christian. You don't have to be afraid to say you love Jesus. It's a good thing, and it's a powerful thing. And the world may reject you, the world or the people, you know what I mean? Who cares? They'll be calling you when you know what hits the fan. Amen. I need help, brother. But then he says to the subjects. So the subjects that didn't want him to be king, right? Talking about the people that reject Jesus. Pharisees or anybody. This is the word of God. It's good then, it's good now. It means something then, it means something now. He says that people that reject Jesus will be judged. And the way that he used it in the context was that, bring those enemies of mine who did not want me to be king over them, bring them here and kill them in front of me. That was the context. But that's judgment. So, boom. Right? Okay, see ya. I'm going to Jerusalem. That's a heavy parable right there. But it's the truth. It's not politically correct. Oh my gosh, he's so mean. He's going to judge some people that reject him. See, that kind of like we're stuck in this world now where everybody's got to be okay. Everybody's got to feel good. You know? But here's the truth. It's solid truth. You reject Jesus, you will be judged. Truth. So why I say Jesus is gnarly. He flexed his spiritual muscles and then took off for Jerusalem to step in to the Lamb. Luke 19. As he approached Bethpage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.' Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They replied, 'The Lord needs it.' They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. As they went along, people spread their cloaks on the road." Now, there's a couple things here. One, Jesus rode on a donkey to fulfill scripture that was prophesied 500 years prior. 500! In Zechariah 9:9, "Rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, on the foal of a donkey." A donkey is a symbol of peace and royalty. As we'll read in a little bit, King Solomon was by King David, King Solomon rode on his donkey and was crowned king. It was part of that. Now, but it's not just a donkey. It was an unridden foal of a donkey. Now, I don't know if you've ever tried to ride something that's never been rode before, but it doesn't say that Jesus rodeoed into Jerusalem. If you've ever jumped on anything, remember being a kid and jumping on your dog? They don't like it. But see, it's confirmation that when we sing the earth will praise him. The animals, the creation knows who the creator is. That donkey was cool with Jesus riding on him. No bucking involved. He's always in control. Now, a warrior comes on a horse. Jesus came in peace on an unbroken donkey. But let me tell you something. He went through the east gate of Jerusalem as a lamb. But he's coming back, and he's going to kick down the front door as a warrior on a horse. He's coming back. He went in as a lamb because that was the time for that. He's coming back as a warrior on a horse with King of Kings and Lord of Lords tattooed on his inner thigh. And I'm going to be riding with him. Get him, Jesus! Get him, Jesus! Hey. You guys will see me then, and you'll be like, "There he is. That's what he said he was going to do." Screaming at Jesus. Now, there's foreshadows of Jesus in the Old Testament. I want to read these because they're important. It ties the old to the new. 1 Kings chapter 1, 32-35. King David said, "Call in Zadok the priest, Nathan the prophet, and Benaiah, son of Jehoiada." I'm sure that there's, that guy. When they came before the king, he said to them, "Take your Lord's servants with you and have Solomon, my son, mount my own mule and take him down to Gihon. There have Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet anoint him king over Israel. Blow the trumpet and shout, 'Long live King Solomon!' Then you are to go up with him, and he is to come sit on my throne and reign in my place. I have appointed him ruler over Israel and Judah." Foreshadow. And Jesus is from the line of David. It all makes sense. You know, it all ties together. It's radical. It's radical when you think about it. Abraham and Isaac, Genesis 22, 2 through 8. Then God said, take your son to Abraham. Take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on the mountain I will show you. Early the next morning, Abraham got up and loaded up his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there, and we will worship, and we will come back to you. Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father Abraham, father, yes, my son, the fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham answered, God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. And the two of them went on together. Now, they're on that mountain, and at that time, Abraham was about to sacrifice his son to the Lord, and the God stopped him and said, look, there's a ram stuck in a bush over there. And he did provide that sacrifice for that day. But I want you to hear this sentence again, because it is literally a prophecy. God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering. And God did, through Jesus, the final one, the final lamb. Now, all four Gospels record this event. Palm Sunday, the crucifixion, and the resurrection. All four Gospels. Only two Gospels record Jesus' birth, which really tells us, because, I mean, we celebrate birthdays. Hey, happy birthday! You know, it's special. You were born. That's awesome. But it's not nearly as important on how you finish. Your birth is not nearly as important as how you finish. How Jesus finished his life was way more impactful. Amen? That gives us hope. And you know what? It's never, never too late to start. The thief on the cross finished well. You know, if you might have screwed up this morning, hey, today's the day. It's never too late. It's never too late to either make Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, to rededicate your life. It's never too late. Now, getting close to the end, so I'm going to start putting a bow on this. Matthew 21, 8 and 9 says this. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Hosanna, save us now. This thing is bothering me. You see, everybody, the time had come. Jesus was king. He was heading into Jerusalem. It was on and cracking. And everybody, man, they had stuff going on in their lives. They had, you know, there was stuff going on, but nobody cared. All they did was focus on Jesus. All they did was focus on the king. And man, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We need to be encouraged in this. And I want to leave you definitely with something today that you can apply. Because I've been going through a little bit of a hard season. And I've learned something through this. When things are going crazy in your life, when you feel defeated, sad, beat down. You don't feel like praying. You don't feel like worshiping. Any of you guys ever felt that way? Okay. That is when you choose to worship God. That is when you stop what you're doing and you go, you know what? I make you big. Instead of making my problems big, because if I focus on my problems, if I focus on the things that are making me feel defeated, then they're big. And then I make God real small, even though he's not. But when I focus on Jesus, when I focus on the one who can, and the one who does, and the one who will, my problems get small. And this is, I do it this way, you do it whatever way you want. But I'll hop in my truck or whatever, wherever I'm at. I got Pandora on my phone. Dude, I'll put on Hillsong United, some really deep worship. And I will get down. I will go to the throne instead of the phone. And it works. It works. Because you put everything into perspective. People were putting Jesus in perspective. Nothing else mattered. Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name. Yes! We're saved! The King is here! We can do that today. Same attitude. So then, in Luke 19, it says some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." Like, tell them to shut up. And this is what Jesus said. Jesus didn't say, "It is written." He didn't say, he didn't quote anybody else. You know what he said? I tell you, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. Jesus says, "I am the Word. And all creation will sing." And if you look around on this earth, every tree that's standing, every flower that's blowing in the wind, every mountain is worshiping God. Creation is worshiping God. And we will worship. And he's right. In the manifested presence of God, if we don't worship, man, the stones will cry out. That's how powerful he is. And I love that he put those guys in their place. And he says, "I tell you." Jesus is the teacher that we must pay attention to. If you want to, look, we don't tell you to learn the word and read the word because it's your religious duty. And if you want to be a member of this church, you better read your Bible. We don't say that because of that. We want to encourage you to learn the Word because we want you to really know Jesus. We want you to know how powerful your God is because, see, you know, I hope I fired you up today, but you're going to leave, and life is out there, and it wants to stomp you out. You're not good enough, you know what I mean? You need this credit card, you need this card, you need face to pull back, you know what I mean? Like, it wants to stomp out the fire that's lit in you. But you know what's going to fan that flame? The Word of God. The presence of God. You praying and fellowshipping with Him on a regular basis. That will strengthen you. Amen. I'm on fire today, people. And remember that Jesus is into the details. He knows every hair on your head. There's nothing that you've done where he's gone, oh man, now I can't do anything. Chris has really tied my hands this time. He's not tripping. He is the God of the big picture. Now we do have, you know, free choice. Choose to live in his presence. Choose to obey his word because it's true. Choose to live in love and forgiveness and honesty and trust and just choose to love. Choose to live in love. Because it will never fail. Love never fails. Amen? And we can rest in that. We can have trust, confidence, obedience, and overflowing joy even in adversity. Even in the valley, we can go to the throne instead of the phone. And I'm not saying we don't, you know, don't get me wrong. It's good for us to fellowship and lift each other up and pray for each other. So I'm not saying not to do that. But man, I would definitely go to the feet of Jesus. Start there. Because he can and he will. I'm going to leave you with this. Romans 8, 31, 32. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Amen. Hallelujah. We receive that today, God. We receive that today, God. So, this is a powerful God. We've talked about the truth today. We've talked about pressing in to God, to the one who can. Where are you at today? Where are you at today? With everybody's head bowed and every eye closed, please. I want you to think right now. Have you ever given your life to Jesus? Do you know this Jesus? Do you know this Jesus that I'm preaching about this morning? Do you want to know him? Because today's the day. Don't wait. Don't hesitate. Maybe you've given your life to Jesus before, but then, man, you just backslid and you know you haven't been living right and you just want to get right. You just want to readjust. This is about you and God. Your heart and your spirit connecting to his. Don't wait. Don't hesitate. I want to give you an opportunity today to do that, to verbally, publicly do that in prayer. If you've never given your life to Jesus or you've backslid and you want to get right today, I want you to raise your hand. I want to pray for you. Don't be scared. I see your hands. I see your hands. I see your hand. Amen. Amen. There's nothing to be afraid of, nothing to be ashamed of. We're all sinners saved by grace. Jesus loves you and you're relevant. Church, help me pray this. Father God in heaven, thank you for your son Jesus. I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior. Jesus, come into my heart, come into my life, and change me. Today, I turn from my ways, and I turn to you. I will walk with you, and I will talk with you the best of my ability. And I declare, today I'm saved, today I'm changed. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I love you guys. Hey, bring somebody to church next week. He is risen.